Welcome to Talk of the Bay here on KSQD Santa Cruz. I'm Bodhi Chargel. It's good to be with you here on another wonderful Tuesday. On the show, I usually cover the left in Santa Cruz, which naturally means a lot of focus on one of our two viable political parties, that of course being the Democrats. And there is another major political party in our country, whether you believe it or not. And since the election of Barack Obama to be America's first black president in 2008, the Republican Party has really collapsed into a fascist political party, first gradually and then very quickly as Donald Trump took over the party starting in 2015. This descent into fascism, to me, is nothing more than the logical conclusion of the ideological path that the Republicans have been on since the two parties in America switched around the time of the civil rights movement in the mid-20th century. Republicans are currently gathered at their national convention in Milwaukee to renominate Donald Trump for president of the United States. This is going to be his third consecutive presidential election at the top of the Republican ticket. With the Republicans in Wisconsin is K-Squid's very own Chris Krohn, on the ground covering the convention. And in the next hour coming up, we've got interviews with protesters and Trump delegates, and also a Republican street performer named Uncle Jam, who you're going to hear in just a moment. It's all coming up on K-Squid, and we will go live to Chris Krohn in Milwaukee when we come back in just a couple of moments.
Chris Krohn, KSQD, with Uncle Sam. Uncle Sam.
That's right. I was just concerned with Lee Greenwood there.
Who's Lee Greenwood?
He wrote God Bless the USA.
Oh, is he here?
Yes. Proud to be an American.
Why are you here?
I'm here to support freedom and truth, the American way. I just sing parodies, sing the truth to power.
Can you sing a parody for us?
They packed Joe Spax last night, campaign fly, gave him his meds at 9 a.m., and it's gonna be high as a kite by then. Forgets his words so much, forgets his wife, and lonely Joe's headspace. It's such a mindless play. I don't think it's gonna be a long, long time until they see that Biden's lost his mind. He's not the man they think he is at all. Oh, no, no, no. He's a puppet man. Puppet man learning how to use his earphone.
What do you call yourself? What's your name?
Uncle Jam.
Uncle Jam. Where are you from?
America.
America. Is that with a K?
With a C. Nice try, though.
Thank you, Uncle Jam.
Oh, following that masterful musical performance and masterful interviewing by Chris Krohn, we're back here on Talk of the Bay, and joining us live is Chris from Milwaukee. Thanks for covering the convention for K-Squid. Thanks for making the flight, the trip out there.
Well, thanks, Bodhi. And I don't know if Joe Thomas is in the studio, but hello, Joe, as well.
Oh, they are.
And it feels pretty okay being here. I do have to take two showers a day, though. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, you sound great.
I was involved in covering a large demonstration involving over 100 groups the other day, mostly on the left, and they all had a common loathing for Donald J. Trump. I also hung out a bit with our Scotts Valley Trump delegate, Kristen Collishaw. And if folks go to the KSQD website, they can hear that show from last night, which included the voices of many of the protesters as well. Today, me and my daughter, Isabel, who is here with me reporting for the Squid, for KSQD, we're on the delegate. We're on the Republican delegate hunt, searching for responses to the question, how has the attempted assassination of Donald J. Trump on July 14th in Butler, Pennsylvania, changed the tone and tenor within the GOP family? I want to listen to three of these delegates and get Bodhi, you and Joe's feedback after we hear. We have one Mike from Portland, Texas, and then we go to Kathy from Orange County, California, and then there's Cynthia from LA County. And why don't we just listen? Mike is the first one. Let's take a listen.
You know, there's a lot of sadness, I think, around the attempted assassination on the part of Donald Trump. And how do you think your fellow delegates are feeling, and how do you feel as the convention began, and maybe you feel differently now?
I think that there was a lot of sadness, and him showing up yesterday just erased the sadness, and the exhilaration was back, and the support was back, and everyone was excited for him. So,
where are you from?
Portland, Texas.
Food and tenor. Do you think it's changed at all from the attempted assassination on former President Trump?
I think there's a lot more motivation going on, and I think everybody's much more grateful for him and wanting to work harder. That's the feeling I'm getting.
And I just heard Vivek Ramaswamy say that first you felt anger and shock, or shock and anger, and then the second phase is, what are we going to do about it? What do you think you could do about it, or how things changed?
Well, unfortunately, I remember the Reagan assassination, and I just remember, I was a child, but I do remember the president saying his life belonged to God afterward, and that was what motivated him. And seeing Mr. Trump last night at the convention on the floor, there was definitely a different look to him. I know that fighter spirit's still in him, but it's nice to see that human side as well. And I know that I'm going to work my tail off even more so he can get into office again, because I believe in him.
This is Isabel O'Malley-Krohn with KSQD Radio. And I have with me here Cynthia Gabaldon, who is a California delegate. What district, or where are you in California?
LA County.
Oh, great. Yeah. I'm from Santa Cruz, so a little bit more up north. But yeah. So the main question that we have right now is, how do you think the attempted assassination of former President Donald Trump has affected the convention and also the race?
When it comes down to the convention, I think it was an automatic, what's the best word? It just automatically focused everybody. And even some people who may not have been all in, everybody's all in now, and we're just ready to go forward. When it comes down to the race, only because it just happened on Saturday and I haven't been home, but at least from the posts I've seen and from other people I know, they're like, what is going on? This isn't right. And I think the race is just going to happen, and it's going to be President Donald Trump again. Thank goodness.
Well, those are some interesting interviews. Chris, nice work on getting the folks together and giving us the ability to hear from them.
All in. Do you think it's going to be a Trump presidency, Bodie?
I'm not a great prediction maker on these kinds of things. I'm pretty good at predicting, you know, NBA draft busts, but I don't have any idea what's going to happen 6 months from now.
Is Joe Thompson there? Joe, what do you think?
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to tell if this is really going to help Trump in the polls. But it seems like he's already leading in most battleground states, so it's going to be hard. But I mean, I think this kind of shifts the focus, you know, back from Biden to Trump. And it's you know, this is clearly showing that the Democratic Party needs to either pick a new candidate or organize behind Biden to kind of combat Trump's new wave, this red wave that's swelling up.
Well, I'd like to know from Joe and Bodie, both of you, what went through you when you first heard that the former president was shot in the ear, nicked his ear, I guess, and there was an attempt on his life. What did you think at that moment, and how did you feel?
Well, frankly, I was a little bit bummed that they missed. That was my snap reaction, but obviously that's an emotional response.
I like your honesty.
Thinking about it rationally, and you know, with a political brain, what it really told me, it showcased the instability, the political division, and the danger that has been on the rise in the U.S. Over the past few years, that frankly has been brought on by Donald Trump and the political movement that he's sort of the head of. On one hand, that's disappointing, and it's a scary thing to see happening in my country. But honestly, if you look around the world, 250 years of American history, with no revolutions, one civil war, and a handful of assassinations on heads of state is an exception globally. We've enjoyed a great deal of stability that is unfortunately now falling apart. Donald Trump and the Republicans are divided. They're chaotic to the point that an attempt on Trump's life was almost successful by a registered Republican. That's an important thing to remember. So it's a scary to live in a country with that going on. But just as the Republicans feel this way, I feel similarly that it's motivating to be living through history happening.
Joe, Bodie before called the Republicans a fascist party. What's your thoughts on that? How could is fascism attracted 77 million votes in 2020? That was the most votes a Republican president ever got.
I mean, to me, it's fascism, but they code it through white nationalism, and it's something that they're trying to unite everyone behind. And you know, this is where Project 2025 comes in, where they're leading to a more fascist regime.
You said Agenda 2025?
Or Project 2025.
You want to say what that is?
Yeah, Project 2025 is through the Heritage Foundation, where it's a whole schematic plan of what to do for the next Trump administration. And it has some crazy ideas of replacing civil servants and lots of other things that I think would be pretty detrimental to our country if implemented. And Trump is claimed he knows nothing about it, but a lot of the people from his former administration are the key architects behind this project. And it's just coded with complete overtaking of our country and destroying democracy.
Just to expand on the previous conversation, talking about fascism, talking about the assassination attempt on Donald Trump, I think it's an important distinction because, Chris, you mentioned 77 million votes, and that was how many votes Trump got in 2020, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah.
And
yes,
there are not 77 million fascists in America. I believe that strongly. I believe that there are a non-zero amount of fascists in America, but it would be wrong to condemn every single Trump voter as a fascist, and it would be even worse to condemn every single Trump voter as morally bad or beyond a rehabilitation or something like that. And this is part of why I find your interviews at the Republican convention to be so interesting, is because you're exploring sort of a mid-level of the Republican Party. These aren't the low-information voters, the 77 million people who voted for Trump, but these also aren't the people leading the party. This isn't Donald Trump and J.D. Vance and Josh Hawley and Marjorie Taylor Greene, the people who I'm perfectly happy to morally condemn. These are the people who hold a role in the Republican Party similar to the one that Joe and I and you hold in the Democratic Party, as somewhere between an activist, a politician, and a member of the public. So I'm happy to hear you doing this work, and I'm enjoying this not just as a host and an interviewee, but a listener as well.
Well, in a second here, I want to come back to this question of delegate thoughts and feelings and the mood of the convention after that attempt on Donald Trump's life. Because some of the delegates I interviewed had some darker thoughts. But I first want to bring into the conversation Christina Bellantoni, the director of the Media Center and a professor of professional practice at the University of Southern California's Annenberg School of Communication and Journalism. Professor, welcome to Talk of the Bay.
Happy to be on.
Hey, could you offer us a brief overview of what the Electoral College means in this day and age? And aren't we really ready to abandon it, given how many presidents have won the Electoral College vote without winning the popular vote, including Donald Trump? What do you think about that?
It's a question that I actually include an entire unit on when I teach politics and government affairs reporting. And one of the things that I kind of conclude with is tell my students that even though the Electoral College system is antiquated and frankly seemingly broken, there are too many people who profit both actually with dollars and also just sort of with power structures for the current system for there to be much incentive to change it. And it would take, you know, nothing short of a complete revolution in our country, which you never know. We're not so far from that in some areas to see a change there. And so in some ways we're stuck with it. And what I try to present to the students is, what's the alternative? The alternative might be an election just based on pure popular vote, and then it would be fought on television and who could raise the most money. And isn't it better to have the candidates sort of forced to go speak to people in smaller regions where they are able to have more retail campaigning and address the issues, you know, of particular states? But then when you also think about how different our system is and how different states are, particularly state laws on major issues, including, you know, environmental policy, reproductive rights, and on and on. Even today in California, a major difference in education policy regarding young people who are transgender. There's a lot there, and it really does require candidates to come and speak to each state individually rather than having a national message to just drive out their people.
But for Professor Bellantoni, have you ever encountered, why is the Electoral College not on the Democratic agenda? Why is there not a constant discussion about that? Because it's the only way, it seems to me, that Republicans as a party are hanging on to much power in the United States.
Yeah, it's a fair question. And I know every year there will be bills in Congress introduced to abolish it. And there just has never been enough support for it. And it's partially because what I just mentioned with, you know, the power structures of consultants and pollsters and, you know, the advertising industrial complex and all of those humans, mostly in Washington, who really benefit from understanding that system and how to game the system. And the argument is that the places where Democrats are not strong happen to be places that are having outsized importance, right? You know, whether you call it the Rust Curtain or whatever, Bible Belt and a lot of other places. But when you actually look at how the Electoral College numbers are allotted, it is because of the census. And we know, one thing we know for certain is that in 2020, the census count was not accurate. We've seen the ramifications of that in many, many states. But we also know, for example, California lost one Electoral College vote for the first time since its founding, because it had always been a place of growth, but more people left the state. And in some ways, that is a product of federal policy and state policy that perhaps does make sense. Ohio used to be 20 Electoral College votes, and now it remains important, but there are two fewer Electoral College votes because people were leaving Ohio and going to places like Florida and Texas. So in some ways, it is reflective of just sort of the way the nation migrates. But in many other ways, it is just about preserving that power center.
We're speaking with Christina Bellantoni, the director of media of the Media Center, and is a professor at USC's Annenberg School of Communication and Journalism. Bodhi and Joe Thompson, you want to weigh in here?
Yeah, I'm happy to. And I think the first question that has to be asked after you, I think, very accurately laid out what the Electoral College does in basically giving Republicans a chance to win the presidency when, if it were just up to a popular vote, they really wouldn't. And then distilling the election down, the presidential election down, to a much smaller number of voters than the, you know, 350 million Americans who live here. And I know not all of those people are registered voters, but I don't have that number off the top of my head. You know, in California, basically none of us get campaigned to in the presidential election because our state is going to go to a Democrat unless something really out of the ordinary happens. Those campaign efforts are focused instead on Michigan, Wisconsin, Pennsylvania, Georgia, et cetera, et cetera. It used to be Ohio and Florida, right? And the question here is there are two questions. One, why do we choose to leave the decision of who chooses the president, these voters in Michigan, Wisconsin, Pennsylvania, Georgia, why do we choose to give it to those voters? What does that accomplish? And then, yeah, what are the impacts of that? And I'll suggest that that's kind of laid the groundwork for the rise of the American brand of fascism that's overtaken the Republican Party. I mean, this disingenuous appeal to working class grievances of, you know, this mythical former factory worker or coal miner who came to be the sort of image of Trump's base in 2016.
Yeah, you know, I do think that we're in danger of that. And the other thing that we're not really talking about that is kind of adjacent but also equally important is we know that there were actual plots to install people who would not vote for the person who won their chosen state in 2020, right? So we know that the system itself, while it might work mathematically and even sort of philosophically, we know that it is subject to corruption and also does not stand up to a lot of scrutiny when you look at, you know, even sort of the premise of, like, what's the difference between a delegate who we see, you know, dancing wearing a Trump, you know, outfit at the Republican National Convention today and an actual elector? Well, sometimes they're the same people, right? They can be party activists, people who are engaged, you know, who are chosen by the party to represent their state. They're not members of Congress, and that's, like, the biggest difference between who we see at the convention. You know, every member of Congress is a delegate for their state and their senator, and then you also have, you know, party officials like Jimmy Carter is a Democratic delegate, for example, from Georgia. So all of those sort of reasons that make it rife for corruption are a reason to look at reform. And in the end, when you think about so many of these systems that we have, like the whole concept of why it's even called electoral college is because it's a gathering, it's a meeting. It's about as modern as the caucus system, which is also sort of slowly getting phased out with those, you know, meetings and the way that they work and the way that they're frankly exclusionary of the whole, right? They are representative of people who have the ability to, you know, campaign for the role and or take time off work, etc.
Just to respond to Bodie's query about number of voters, Reuters reports that there's 239 million eligible voters and only 206 million registered voters. Professor Bellantoni from USC, could you respond to the notion of the Republican Party turning into a fascist party? And I know that Jack Beatty, the political analyst from Dartmouth, says that it really is the cult of Trump. The Republican Party has turned into a cult. Could you respond to those two criticisms?
Yeah, I mean, I've been a professional journalist for my whole career now, nearing 25 years, and I've covered both parties. And, you know, if I were a poli-sci professor, I think I'd sort of want to get into that debate. What I find is that there are corrupt people in both parties, and I also find that we have a rhetoric and a system of policy proposals that are really alarming for me just as a human, you know, as a mom, as somebody that's trying to, like, make sure we still have a functioning democracy at the end of all of this. I am concerned about a lot of the rhetoric and a lot of the ideas. And in the end, the basic governing structures have mostly maintained through this extremely tumultuous period of time. And so, you know, I'm never going to label somebody a fascist because that's not in my DNA as a journalist. While I can recognize that what I see as a human is frankly quite alarming. And also, there are plenty of Republican voters who want the exact same things for their family that I do, and we just have like some disagreements that are completely not personal, right? People that fundamentally believe that abortion is wrong, I don't believe that, right? Like, so one of the exercises I have my students do is really throw out the idea of objectivity out the window. No one is objective. Like, that is garbage nonsense created by old white men a long time ago. What I do want them to recognize is that their own worldview is not the only worldview, and it is important for them, if they want to go into the career of journalism, to attempt to listen to and warmly reflect the ideals of people that don't represent their own worldview. And while it like sounds really simple when I say it like that, it's actually quite a struggle for many of them, especially living here in LA or going to a big liberal university, to do.
Thank you for saying that. And before we let you go, Joe Thompson, you have a question.
Yeah, I'm just very curious, Professor, about what your students think of the Electoral College in comparison to something like the National Compact Interstate Voter Act or another, you know, proposal like that.
I mean, they hate it. It's one of the first questions they ask. You know, why can't we have campaign finance reform? Why can't we fix the Electoral College system? Because it makes no sense. And you have to remember, the majority of them are first-time voters this year, right? So they haven't even, like, they've only known kind of the end of President Obama and President Trump and then now Biden, you know, pretty broken set of years, I would say, for them to observe the political process. So yeah, it doesn't make any sense to them. And in the end, there's going to have to be some change someday. I frankly believe that we'll see campaign finance reform before we see Electoral College reform, just because there are ways that people can profit off the system differently, and so they're creative enough to come up with those, just as we saw, you know, following Citizens United and the rise of super PACs.
Well, we're going to leave it there. I really appreciate your time, Christina Bellantoni, the director of the Media Center and the professor of professional practice at USC's, University of Southern California's Annenberg School of Communication and Journalism. Thank you so much, Professor.
My pleasure. Have a good one.
This is KSQD 90.7 and KSQD.org. We're coming to you from the studios of Harvey West Park, but I, Chris Krohn, am in Milwaukee, Wisconsin today. And today, my daughter and myself were interviewing Republican delegates. There were 16. We did 16 interviews in total, and there were some who expressed a darker view of what happened on July 14th in Bethel, Pennsylvania. That is when someone took a shot at Donald Trump. The folks we're about to hear basically blame Democrats for it.
My name is Yvonne Clouser. I'm a national delegate, and the attempted assassination on President Trump, they failed. So they've tried everything in the book, and this was the last straw. So they just gave him the presidency. It's going to be a landslide.
Who is the they, you think?
Oh, God, don't get me started. We'll just say the Democrats, although it's deeper than that.
And, you know, I just heard Vivek Ramaswamy say the first thing we were feeling was shock and anger, and the second thing is to what are we going to do about it? What would you do about it?
The first thing I said was, oh, my God, no, he'll live and not die. He'll live and not die. And then he stood up, and we're like, he's alive, yay! And that was it, because we were like, what are we going to do now? But he rose up. He got up.
It wasn't even the third day,
But it was still divine intervention. It was, because if he wouldn't have complained about the prompts and looked to the right, it would have hit him in the head, because we're both retired military. And, you know, to me it was a setup, because everybody saw the guy climbing up the roof, and they pointed him out to the FBI or police, and they didn't do anything. You tell me what's with that, you know? Insane, wrong.
Just wondering what you're finding the tone and tenor of the convention in the aftermath of the attempted assassination on Donald Trump. How are you feeling, and how you think your fellow delegates are responding to that?
current president of the United States is attempting to kill the candidate, his opponent, and that's how it looks to about everybody. So, and that's it shows in the polls, and it's showing him that this president will do anything to achieve his goals. And that's where I look at it as it's just he can't win it. He can't win into the legal warfare, so he has to use the just like a gangster.
When you actually saw the former president down, how were you feeling?
Well, the feeling is it was more shock. I mean, it just understanding about why it happened. It has lots of questions to it. I find it odd that it happened in Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania has been difficult to getting a thorough investigation for whatever reason. And that happens even at the state level. So there seems to be a connection there between President Biden and some federal influence. I guess I'm not...
Do you see any evidence that you've been privy to that would indicate the Democrats somehow were behind this attempt?
You don't need evidence at this point. It just right before the convention, some kid that has no history out of nowhere, you might as well change his name to Lee Harvey Oswald.
Thank you. Could I get your name?
No. Thank you.
No, but you're an Iowa delegate.
Yes, I am.
Thank you.
You don't need evidence.
That's it all. The current president of the United States is attempting to kill the former president of the U.S. This is the country we're living in, guys, you know?
You know, the Supreme Court did make it legal for Biden to order a drone strike on Donald Trump like a week ago. This is way, if Biden was behind it, he wouldn't have had to go to this much effort. He could have just done it. And the Supreme Court says that he's cool to do that. No need for all the cover up nonsense.
Yeah. It's a bit disturbing. And I don't understand the whole thing with Pennsylvania is they don't necessarily all agree with the current president's view of the world. So why that?
There is a conspiracy theory to be laid out there, since Pennsylvania has a Democrat governor, but it seems like the guy that you were just talking to doesn't even know that much. And by the way, to be clear, I assure folks listening that Pennsylvania's Democrat governor has nothing to do with the fact that some guy tried to kill Donald Trump.
Yeah, no, there's no way.
Chris, are you still with us?
I am. I had a little cough. Exactly. Maybe that's where that guy was going. I didn't realize he's talking about a Democratic governor, and that's there's an in there or something.
I don't think he was talking about anything. I don't think that he had laid out a clear theory. I think that he was crafting a reality to match the feelings that he felt when watching Fox News or Newsmax.
There was a Republican representative that I heard talking to Charlie Kirk, who has a radio show, a very popular radio show amongst Republicans. And he seemed to suggest that it wasn't just negligence on the part of Homeland Security and the Secret Service, basically. They're involved in the investigation, and they were responsible for not securing that building. But the two people you just heard, this is not unusual from what I've been hearing the last 2 days being here in Milwaukee, Wisconsin at the Republican convention. There's thousands of delegates, and this is a strong current running through folks. Of course, there's other people who just sit outright reject that. I brought that up with other delegates, and they say, no, I'm not going the conspiracy route. I turn my ears off when I hear that stuff going, but they say they do hear it also.
I'm glad it's not all of them, but it is, if I'm not mistaken, it's one of Umberto, it's not Echo. I always get this confused. It's one of the 14 points that can be used to identify a fascist political movement, a reliance on conspiracy.
It's not Gramsci, Antonio Gramsci you're talking about?
Yeah, I think that's it. Thanks.
Yeah.
It's just another thing that's, you know, deeply disturbing is the Republican Party has become just so reliant on conspiracism that they can't turn it off and they can't excise it from their own party. I don't think they're in control of that anymore.
Joe Thompson, you agreeing with that?
Yeah, I mean, it's the conspiracy theories are just rotten to the core at this point. You know, you have Marjorie Taylor Greene talking about Jewish space lasers, for God's sake. And it seems like there's nothing that the Republicans won't stoop to so low. And I think that, you know, as it comes out that it was a registered Republican who fired the shots at Trump, and they're still trying to blame Democrats, the Democratic media and everything. It just, you can't.
Oh, but Joe, what about that $15 donation he made to a liberal cause?
I don't know. I $15. It doesn't seem like it's that
people
much.
People mention that every time I bring that up. They mention the $15 he gave. But it's interesting. They don't have anything on this guy, and that's why the conspiracies are running rampant right now. They didn't get the classmates talking about him as, you know, an outlier. Mm-hmm. Really, he was quiet. But and he has no track record of ever being arrested, he didn't leave a journal behind. He didn't leave. So far, they haven't found stuff on his computer, I guess.
Right. I hate to say this, but I think it should be said that for not all Republicans, but for many Republicans, part of what doesn't make sense to them with this whole story and with the profile of the would-be assassin who tried to kill Donald Trump is that he was a straight cis white guy. And that just simply doesn't match the profile of someone who would do this kind of thing in the mind of Republicans. So given the lack of information that exists, as well as the information that we have that doesn't match with their worldview, with their presuppositions, I think that can explain part of the prevalence of conspiracy theories where they don't have some information. Some of the information doesn't match what they feel, so they'll just make up their own information.
I was interviewing David Bossie, Bossie. He's the co-chair of the Trump campaign for 2024 yesterday, or Sunday, actually. And he just laid into the Secret Service and just said how irresponsible they were. I mean, just opening up all this stuff, like somehow there was, skullduggery, treachery behind this assassination attempt. And at the same time, he was saying what a great job they're doing here at the convention, keeping everyone safe. Between the time that Donald Trump was shot on Saturday night, July 14th, and Sunday, people told me here they doubled the security. You know, it's an armed camp. It is. You wouldn't believe just security checkpoints and the number of police from around the country, as well as National Guard, and just other troops. You know, I don't know where they're all from, but it is. I guess we're safe, you know, with the number of guns we have here.
This may be a bit of a cheap shot, but is the party of the Second Amendment and the party of good guys with guns allowing conventioneers to bring guns into their own convention?
You know, I don't. There is a metal detectors that you have to go through when you come into what they call the hard zone. There's a soft zone, which is around, and then there's a hard zone. And that became a big issue with the protesters yesterday wanting to enter the hard zone, but they weren't able to. But they negotiated a place close enough where the delegates could hear them. And that was their goal. There was about 2,000 protesters.
Oh, wow.
The presence of metal detectors would imply that you can't bring a gun into the hard zone, which, you know, if the logic is that the only thing that keeps us safe from bad guys with guns is good guys with guns, then that would go against that assumption.
I'm pretty sure you can bring them into the Capitol. I think the elected representatives can can carry in the Capitol. I want to get, there's some comments from, I thought really interesting because, and Joe, you especially, who has done a lot of organizing with the Starbucks union organizing effort. I really want to hear from you because I'm hearing it from J.D. Vance to Vivek Ramaswamy, who ran for president, and this person who leads the Republican delegation from California. His name is Timothy O'Reilly. He's a lawyer from Long Beach. And his remarks concerning the party of, of Trump, also maybe being the party of labor. Let's have a listen to Timothy O'Reilly, and I'd love to, and actually run them both. Vivek Ramaswamy's are just like 35 seconds after Timothy O'Reilly.
This is Isabel O'Malley-Krohn reporting for KSQD Radio, Talk of the Bay, and I have here with me...
My name is Timothy O'Reilly. I'm the chairman of the Republican Party of Los Angeles County.
Great. Thank you so much for being here with me today. And you are a delegate for Long Beach, it looks like?
That's correct.
Okay. So the question today is, how do you think the assassination attempt on former President Donald Trump has changed the state of the race and also changed the tone of the convention?
I probably more than anything, it's brought a certain level of seriousness to it. But I think it's also really bonded the Republicans to know that there are actually people out there trying to kill our candidate. That's probably the most significant thing that has happened. We were unified coming in. Now I think there's a bond now that exists that didn't exist.
Ladies and gentlemen,
thank you. And being from California, I just want to ask, what do you think it's like to be a Republican in California and also to support Donald Trump? Do you think that's something that's catching on? Do you think Donald Trump would support or represent California were he to win?
Well, I have no question about him representing California. Donald Trump actually loves California. In terms of Republicans in California, people forget that there are, just within Los Angeles County, I have over 1 million Republicans in Los Angeles County. That is larger than some states' populations. If Los Angeles County by itself was its own state, it'd be about the 12th largest state in the entire country. So Donald Trump actually got more raw votes out of the state of California in the 2020 election than any other state in the country. 6.2 million votes is what he got. And I think many Californians are just sick of it. I'm sick of paying $6 a gallon for gas. I paid $9 a gallon for gas about a year ago. That is insane. The working class people in the state, I think, are done. And they're gonna vote with their feet. So are we gonna get to the point where we finally flip California back to red? Depends, frankly, on Los Angeles County because of the weight of Los Angeles. But I think you're gonna see a huge shift. And even in San Francisco, I think you're gonna see people who are done with it. There is you look at the new platform for the RNC, it finally does away with the gay marriage issue. That's a non-issue. Same thing with the abortion issue. We're against late-term abortions. So I think J.D. Vance comes in and represents truly a working class group of people. You know, his book, Hillbilly Elegy, talking about somebody who grew up in grinding poverty and made something of himself. Ohio State University undergraduate, Yale Law School, again, all self-made man. And I think that's truly the American dream, is the opportunity to take yourself from grinding dirt poverty and making yourself. Now, again, he's at the point where he is a national candidate. He's going to be our next vice president. And he, I think, is going to reach out and talk to really what has always been the Republican base in my mind, and that is the working people of this country.
All right. Thank you so much. Okay.
But that quick question, is the former Republican corporatist state turning into a workers' party?
I think we should turn into, and what we're going to turn into, it's going to be this. And my vision and my hope for this movement is we have a national libertarian vision of shutting down the bureaucracy. I believe that should be the number one goal. And the more focused we are on that, the more successful we're going to be.
Just to be clear, J.D. Vance is not self-made. He's made by Peter Thiel. I just want to get that out there. But it looked like Joe had something to say.
Yeah, I mean, you come from working class. That doesn't mean that you're pro-working class. And I think that's very clear with J.D. Vance that, he is not pro-labor at all. He has a zero, AFL-CIO score. And I don't think the Republican Party is doing anything to really, try and appease labor And then having, you know, Sean O'Brien come out and speak at the RNC, it's just shows that they're stretching unemployment threads to try and get into, you know, the labor movement and try and, you know, try and pick off some Democratic support.
I really wanted to make sure we got into that Sean O'Brien speech, and I want to spend some time talking about that because Sean O'Brien's the president of the Teamsters, the largest union in the U.S., if I'm not mistaken, or at least one of them. And he's, I mean, he's potentially going to get ousted from his role as Teamsters president over the speech that he gave last night at the convention. I mean,
unbelievable, isn't it?
It is, to me, the most textbook example of 30 minutes of just straight up class treason. I mean, in the speech, he called Donald Trump, who is the most consequentially anti-union president in recent memory, a tough SOB. And he said that J.D. Vance truly, I quote, truly cares about the working class. I mean, the thesis of the speech, to the degree that one existed, and I mean, it was like a half hour speech. He said like three things, like most of it was saying nothing. But to the degree that the speech had a thesis, it was this gesturing at a potential, you know, bipartisan working class union support in the U.S. That potential is not real. I mean, the Republican Party is a party of elites. It is an anti-union, anti-worker party. And the fact that a union leader is going to be on stage at their convention implying anything else is heinous, despicable, and disappointing.
But Bodie, they are going for the worker jugular, not just in practice, but they want that vote. And
they are.
I've never seen this happen before. I've never seen the Republicans reach, and I hear the word working class, and workers. I hear that all the time here at this convention. I hear people talking about it, and I've never heard that. This is my fourth Republican convention, and I've never heard it before.
Well, frankly, part of it is them talking about American workers, it's a racist dog whistle, because to them, white people are employed, and they're still gesturing at the idea of the, you know, black welfare queen. They think that people of color can't hold down a job. So part of it, when the Republicans talk about supporting workers, is that whole rhetorical thing, that terminology is a racist dog whistle that they use. But it is also just this disingenuous campaign strategy that they used successfully in 2016 and in J.D. Vance's race in Ohio to reach, you know, these disenfranchised blue collar white workers who, by voting for Republicans, are voting for the exact people who got them in to an economic situation with not that great of an outlook.
Joe Thompson, what do you think? I mean, I heard working class, self-made men, there was a whole bunch of, and that was from the chairman of the Republican Party, though. He's of L.A. That was him, Timothy O'Reilly. I mean, he's convinced that this is a working class party right now.
Yeah, I mean, the Republican Party wants to be the party of the working class and have that be their slogan of, like, we're for families. But in reality, in policy, they, you know, complete opposite. And that's seen through Trump's, you know, Supreme Court justices who recently, you know, sided with Starbucks in an anti-union case. This is a president who will not stand on a picket line, won't stand with the workers, has been a scab his entire life. And they're appealing to the working class people by trying to pull labor, and it's just not working at all.
So you didn't meet many self-made people, workers at Starbucks, did you?
No, not at all.
and even using the term self-made, it gestures at this, you know, capitalist bourgeois ideal of economic mobility. The American dream that Republicans support is that anyone can make it. The quiet part that you don't say is that, but everyone can't. the America that Republicans dream of, in that America, anyone can make it, but everyone can't. And any pro-labor party, any working class party would be advocating for an America, for an economic system where everybody can be granted their basic human rights to food, housing, healthcare, self-determination, the ability to live, to have a retirement, education, all of those things. And the Republicans never have and never will advocate for that. Just to take a moment to go over Donald Trump's record on labor. He appointed anti-union judges to the Supreme Court, as Joe mentioned, and federal courts broadly, as well as anti-union appointees on the NLRB, National Labor Relations Board. He banned the use of company email addresses in union organizing, which the Department of Labor under Obama had previously allowed. Trump's Department of Labor actually cost 8 million workers a potential $1 billion per year in overtime pay by changing the definitions of which workers are or are not eligible for overtime pay. Last but not least, he reduced the number of OSHA inspectors active in America to a number lower than any time in the history of OSHA. And I said now, last but not least, but there is much more that I could get into. But it's plainly true that Donald Trump is the most consequentially anti-labor president in our history. J.D. Vance is a Silicon Valley venture capital dude who grew a beard and thought that he could lie about what unions are and what's good for the working class.
But he's going to carry the water now for the president, for the possibly the future president, Donald Trump, in the area of labor, you know. And I have a question for both of you about Vivek Ramaswamy. He was on with Charlie Kirk of Turning Point USA today, incredible conservative, you know, show, right-leaning show. And they have these booths all over the place, you know, where these shows are taking place in this open area, you know, among the convention, not inside, but outside the convention hall. And he said that he talked about the administrative state. And, and in this conversation just now, he talked about libertarian, national libertarian vision, I guess. But he said that he did not just want to slash and burn the administrative state. He wanted to, like, burn the ashes after that. He thinks we need to start over and reinvent. And I don't know if he means reinvent government or reinvent a system.
Yeah, and I mean, this is the, you know, common libertarian thing, is they want to, you know, shut government down. But the reality is that no Republican president has ever, you know, followed through on that promise. You know, Trump said that he wanted to eliminate the Department of Education. He didn't do that. And it's just clear that they're trying to get votes, you know, trying to get as many votes as possible by saying all these, you know, crazy ideas. But in reality, when they get elected, they realize that it's just too big of a task to actually accomplish.
Not that we should trust them not to do it if we give them the chance. I mean, Donald Trump, if he gets the chance to enact Project 2025, I'm sure that he'll try. But let's not give him the chance. I have a lot more thoughts on Vivek Ramaswamy and Charlie Kirk, but I'll for the sake of time, I'll just say that I wouldn't trust any of my female friends or family members to leave a drink uncovered around the two of them.
I don't know what that means, but We will move on. We might have to leave it there. Thanks to the stellar work habits of our engineer, Nyanko, and thanks to Joe Thompson and Bodhi Shargal for holding down the KSQD studio tonight. And to Professor Christina Blantoni from USC. This is Chris Krohn for Talk of the Bay. I'm on the road in Milwaukee. I will be back reporting shorter spots this week on KSQD 90.7 and KSQD.org. Good night and good luck, Santa Cruz.
Have a great week, everyone.
Thanks, Chris. In the cemetery wall, the black car.